morning and a very warm welcome to you this morning here at Stanley Golden Grove United Church, wherever you may be watching us from. And it's nice to see Craig here this morning. Welcome, Craig. It's lovely to see you. As you came in, you would have received your Gazette, lots of information, diary dates in your Gazette. Just a reminder, it's Cafe Church tonight and it's a special Anzac service, so it would be lovely to see as many people as possible turn up tonight for that service. The call to worship this morning comes from Luke 24, verses 50 to 53. When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather here in your house, we ask that you will strengthen us, restore us, and inspire us with your love. Lord, would you fill each of us with your peace, so that as we journey onwards, we would pour out our love and grace to others. In Jesus' name, amen. The next hymn we're going to stand and sing is hymn, Lord Jesus Christ, you have come to us. Now going to have prayers of confession. Heavenly Father, we have come to see that our lives fall short of your glory. You have given your Son for us and poured out your Spirit. Yet we fail to return your love with all our heart. Too often we are selfish and proud, ignoring you and neglecting others. When we do not truly trust and obey you, we are overwhelmed by self-pity, fear, and worry. In Christ, we are given a sure hope and secure love. Yet we follow the false hopers and desires of this world. Father, through the redeeming death of your Son, by your Spirit, and through your word, enable us to follow you with joy. May our love for you help us to love and forgive others and make a difference in our world. Father, we thank you for bringing us safely to another day of worship here at Golden Grove. As we speak to you today, fill our hearts with true praise and thankfulness for you, all you have done for us. Father, let the church grow through the growth of your word among us, as you strengthen us through the daily renewal of our baptism and sharing of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The next hymn we're going to stand and sing is Take My Life and Let It Be. Come to a time for prayers for others, and I will leave a time for anyone who would like prayers for family or friends or for something that's troubling them. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today and thank you for the privilege of praying for others. We thank you that through your name we can come boldly before you in prayer with confidence, according to your will, and know that you hear us. We pray for the homeless, the lost, the hurting, the sick, the bereaved. Send your comfort, your peace, and your calming presence to those who are without hope. We pray for all those in authority and leadership, both locally and throughout the world, that is for the unnecessary bombing and killing of innocent people in Ukraine. Please stop. So we ask that you hear the prayers for your people here today as they either call out the name or pray in silence. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, hear our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. During this time, your offering for the work of the Lord will be waited on. Thank you.
Christ our captain, for now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor.
Of this offering, we tell your story, how you have dealt generously with us, how you have met our needs, how you have heard our prayers, how your goodness is from everlasting to everlasting. Bless these offerings, which are given in the name of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The next hymn we're going to stand and sing is, I Know That My Redeemer Lives. Is this one of Bob's favourites? Tonight at Cafe Church, it's an Anzac service, but I would just like to say a prayer for the Anzacs, and please bow your head. Gracious God, tomorrow an Anzac Day, we bring before you all those who have continued to serve in our defence forces. We remember and give thanks for their service to our country. We pray for all those who suffer in war and continue to suffer through the trauma of war. We pray for comfort in their grief. We pray for supportive communities to journey with them in their struggles, healing and recovery. We give thanks for our Defence Force chaplains. We thank you for your response to the call to offer spiritual leadership and pastoral care to Defence Force personnel and their families. We pray for all those who are negotiating peace in situations of war and conflict throughout our world. Bless them with your wisdom, strength, and resolve to find ways we can live together in harmony and respect for one another. We pray that we might be bearers of your peace. Through Christ, who is our peace, we pray. They shall grow not old, as that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget. Chris will now bring this morning's Bible reading.
This morning's gospel reading is from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. Jesus appears to his disciples. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks on his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hands into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
The next hymn we're going to either sit or stand is "Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise," which will be followed by Dr. James Ross Naylor's sermon on "Blessed Are They, Those Who Have Not Seen." So...
Of day. Good morning. As we come to the message of God, will you pray with me? Father God, be present with us and surround us with the knowledge of your love. Jesus Christ, Word of God, speak your truth through me, so that my words might be not mine but yours. Spirit of God, move our hearts to accept your teaching and be changed, moulded into your new creation. Amen. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That's what Jesus said to Thomas when Thomas saw him and believed in him. We're just coming out of the Easter season, a time of remembering our Lord's death on the cross and his resurrection to life on the third day. As we have just sung, see what a morning. And we know why this happened. It wasn't an accident or a defeat, but rather God's means of showing grace to all people, making a way for us to be saved from our sins by taking them on himself and overcoming death. The question I want to pose today, 1 week after Easter, is what comes next? On the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." If it is finished, then what else is there? What needs to be done? Or to put it another way, when Jesus rose from the dead, he could have simply left the tomb empty for all to discover and returned to his Father right away. He could have, but he didn't. Instead, the Bible says he appeared to a number of his disciples several times over a period of 40 days. And what we've just had read to us was two of those occasions, including one that's quite famous to us, you'd have to say. Those of us who grew up in the church will have heard the story of Doubting Thomas many times, the disciple who didn't believe Jesus had risen even after the others told him, until he had seen Jesus in the flesh with his own eyes. It even enters into common parlance, doesn't it, when we think of people who are overly sceptical or critical or pessimistic. Don't be such a doubting Thomas. Is that how you were taught the story as children in Sunday school or the like? That Thomas doubting Jesus was a bad thing, that he didn't have enough faith, and Jesus was sort of gently telling him off a bit. Stop doubting and believe. That's certainly the easy explanation, but does it match up with what Jesus said? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. We can think there that Jesus is contrasting Thomas with the other disciples who did believe in him, but that's not true because the disciples needed to see him to believe him as well. A week earlier, in the same room, Jesus had appeared to them. And before that, they had been just as doubtful as Thomas was, hiding in a locked house, fearful that they'd be arrested by the Jewish leaders. Then they saw and believed, just like Thomas. Who was Jesus talking about then when he said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed"? We'll get to that later. The important thing to know at this point is that according to Jesus, to what Jesus said, Thomas was no better and no worse than any of the other disciples. He treated them all equally. He appeared to all of them and gave each of them whatever proof they needed in order that they may believe. Even if, in Thomas's case, it meant offering his hands and side for Thomas to touch physically. It raises an interesting question. What do people need in order to believe? What do we need in order to have faith? Those of you who know me know that I grew up in the church, grew up coming to this church, in fact, Golden Grove, with my family. In my teenage years, my family and I left this church and went to another before returning here later. There was a period of time, though, when I was just leaving school and going to university, when my faith was not exactly dead, but stagnant. I believed God existed, as I always had. I believed Christianity was true, as I always had. But even growing up and maturing, I wasn't really living it out. There was a disconnect between going to church on Sunday and my day-to-day life. What I said, what I did, how I thought. What changed really the whole direction of my life was one day when a couple of guys in one of my university classes, who I'd never spoken to before, came and found me in a Hungry Jack store of all places and invited me to a Christian group of university students who met weekly on the campus for 30-minute talks about different passages from the Bible. I went along and found out it was everything I'd never known I needed. Without a doubt, something that God had sent me. At these talks, somewhat similar to sermons, but probably a little more rigorous, we were given notes to follow through. But the meaning behind whatever passage we were doing that week, verse for verse, and how it pointed to the gospel of Jesus Christ, it was explained so clearly and in such detail that I'd never heard before. From this, I learned how to read the Bible, not just as a children's storybook or a moral code, but as the inspired word of God that reveals God to us. I learned to understand different parts of it, Old Testament and New Testament, to study it and desire more knowledge of it, just like, and even more importantly than, the subjects I was studying at uni at the same time. Having always been someone who liked facts and logic, I found a way to pursue faith that involved exactly that. I didn't have to put my brain on the shelf when thinking about God. My thinking was part of my worship. And the actions then followed, because once I truly got who God was, how could it not affect my life? Once I understood, as much as anyone could understand, God's grace through Jesus' death and resurrection, how could that not change me? And so through that, you could say, I came to believe in Jesus, to have faith in him, in a way that surpassed simply calling myself a Christian and going to church every Sunday, to know him and to know who he is. That was my own journey. Now, a handful of years later, I was in a home group, you would call it, with some young adults from the church my parents and I went to before returning to Golden Grove, called The Journey. And we were talking about this very topic, how we came to faith in Jesus and what gives us certainty about believing in him. And one young woman about my age, her answer surprised me a little. She said she didn't really feel there was need for logic or proof. She simply believed. Something in her just knew the gospel was true. And that was enough for her. She didn't really need to understand everything or really that much at all. It was quite different from my own journey. And from one perspective, you could say that's an exceptionally strong faith. That she had this unconditional certainty inside her that didn't depend on any earthly circumstance. I have to admit, though, that my own mind jumped to the worst-case scenario. That is to say, what if she woke up one day and didn't feel so sure anymore? If she didn't have anything solid to build her faith with off, might she change from believing to not believing in an instant, based on nothing more than how she feels at the time? So we have two different ways, at least two different ways, one might come to faith. Is either of these ways better than the other? At the end of the day, we were both believers, weren't we? And are both believers. we both accept and receive God's grace to us through Jesus Christ. And so it is, I believe, with every one of us. Thomas was perhaps more like me, or possibly a fairer way to put it, given I'm living 2,000 years later, would be that if I'd lived in those days, perhaps I would have been like Thomas, wanting facts and proof before I would believe Jesus had really risen. After all, people don't exactly rise from the dead every day, do they? Whereas perhaps some of the other disciples might have been more like this young woman, friend of mine, very swift to believe even at the suggestion of hope, because of what they felt in their hearts was true. In these few moments, for those of us who believe in the Christian gospel, I invite all of us to think on why we believe. What makes us so certain that what we believe in is true? Is it simple, pure conviction of the heart, something you know deep inside you? Is it something you've studied and thought over a long period of time and come to the conclusion, logically and through facts, that it has to be true? Was it your parents or some other Christian mentor who passed down their faith to you, which you hold to after seeing how wonderfully it worked in their life? Perhaps have you yourself been touched by God and experienced him in such an intimate way that you could never deny? Perhaps you have experienced a miracle or a dream. It could be any of these, perhaps more than one, perhaps all of them. All are ways in which God draws people to him and into a place of belief in him. I could draw examples from the Bible of people who God reached in that particular way for any of them. We may take different journeys to faith, but we have one faith. And that is one lesson I think we must draw from Jesus' appearance to Thomas. That, as I said, he was willing to do whatever it took to bring each of his disciples to believe in him. It's not about Thomas's faith being insufficient, although it was insufficient, as were all the disciples and all others. No, it was about Jesus and the grace and love he showed Thomas and the rest of his disciples and everyone. He showed it to them by appearing to them and making it clear without a doubt that he had risen, just as, even today, in all our separate ways, he comes to us and makes it clear to us. And for those who don't believe or who are struggling with doubt, I want to assure you that in his own time, God will make it clear to you as well. It might not be in the way you're looking for or expect, but he will. How do I know? Because that's who he is. That's the character of the God we see in the Bible. That's the character of the God I know. So that's one part. But we left an important question hanging, didn't we, earlier on? When Jesus told Thomas, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." If Jesus isn't talking about his other disciples who by now have seen him, then who is he talking about? Who has never seen the risen Jesus personally and yet believed in him? What about us? What about all Christians through the ages, starting with the very first people to whom the disciples proclaimed the good news, who believed it despite having never seen Jesus in person? Jesus and all the other disciples who Jesus appeared to, Thomas and all the other disciples, they saw and believed, and through them many were blessed because they heard the good news and believed even though they themselves had not seen. See, Jesus' words are not simply a rebuke to Thomas about not believing. They're a call to tell others, to not keep this news to themselves, but to spread it far and wide so that many may be blessed, not just those who have seen in person. If that seems like a stretch, look at what else Jesus says. In his earlier appearance to his disciples, when Thomas wasn't present, "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." He breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now that's another quotation that may seem quite strange to us, because do we have the power to forgive sin? Of course not. There's only one way any human being's sins can be forgiven, and that's through God's grace expressed through Jesus Christ. Which is exactly Jesus' point. He's sending his disciples to show that grace to others, telling them what they are to do and what the stakes are. They are to tell others about him through the power of the Holy Spirit. And through how people receive the message, they will be either saved and forgiven, or they will not be forgiven, they'll be condemned, depending on whether they believe or not. And because of that, these verses are sometimes referred to as John's version of the Great Commission, which of course we know very well from the last few verses of Matthew. "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." I said at the outset that the question I wanted to answer today was what comes next after Easter. The best measure of that we have is what Jesus' own priorities were when his work on the cross was done and when he had risen from the grave. Why did he appear to his disciples? Firstly, to give them the proof they needed to believe he was alive. And secondly, to send them out to tell others that he was alive. Both of those priorities still hold weight today. People need to know Jesus is alive. People need to come to faith so they can be saved. And for all the different ways each of us came to faith, all the different ways we thought about earlier, all the different ways God continues to change hearts even today, one way he chooses to work is through us, spreading the good news of the forgiveness of sin through the resurrected Christ. Jesus called on his disciples to do this, and today we are his disciples. He calls us. So how do we do it? It's not easy. Jesus knew that. The disciples certainly found out how hard it was. And we often find it hard too in a world today that can be quite hostile towards Christianity, towards Jesus. Evangelism would be a topic for a whole other sermon or even a series. But from this passage, I would draw 2 points in particular. Firstly, in order for the disciples to be sent, it was absolutely necessary for them to receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus breathes on them so that they would receive it. And of course, the Spirit would come in power on the day of Pentecost, as we read in Acts chapter 2. It was the Spirit, God himself, who empowered the disciples to share the gospel. That is something we must never forget. That is, it's God who does the saving work, not us. We are nothing without him, and with him there is nothing that can't be done. So we don't have to fear, and we don't have to feel pressured to succeed in our own strength. God's Spirit is within us, as Jesus himself said, "Today, surely I'm with you always, to the very end of the age." The other point is more simple and practical. Just tell us what you've seen. The disciples weren't sent out with a checklist of theological points to make. They were sent out to bring people to believe in Jesus. And that started with they themselves believing when they saw Jesus, when they touched Jesus in his risen flesh. If all of us have had our own different roads to belief, then we each have our own story, our own testimony to share. Look at how John finished his chapter right after these appearances of Jesus. He says Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written so that you may believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is John fulfilling Jesus' commandment to a T. He wrote a book telling of what he saw of Jesus and everything that convinced him that Jesus was the Messiah. If we want to see others believe the gospel, we can start by simply telling our own story and explaining why we believe it. And in all of this, we must never forget that the work's been done. If we forget that, we forget what Easter was for and the very gospel we're proclaiming, that Jesus, the Son of God, died and rose again to extend God's grace to us and bring us eternal life. Nothing can change or stand against that truth. And when we proclaim it, all we're doing is following the command of the one who's already won the battle, in order to see that that same grace would be extended to many. Blessed are we who have not seen and yet have believed. Let's spread those blessings far and wide. Amen. We have a gospel to proclaim, a wonderful hymn that reminds us of where the good news starts and ends with the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what we're witnessing to.
Thank you.
We're about to have the benediction and then our final song. As a reminder, tonight at 6 p.m. we have Cafe Church in the Hall, a special Anzac commemoration service, so please get along to that. And if you'd like to receive prayer for healing or for any other need, there'll be people here at the front of the church to pray for you. So please feel free to remain here if that's what you'd like. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. And our final song is, May the Feet of God Walk With You.